Good evening, students. Welcome to one more session of your World of Chemistry. That is, we are doing grade 10th syllabus, that is of your NCERT. This is valid for both the CBSE as well as the state boards. So we have been doing a lot of topics. I have picked up the first topic, that is the chemical reactions and equations. So I have given the introduction, I have given the types of reactions, I have taught you clearly what are balancing reactions. I have also taught you what are combination reactions, displacement reactions. I need to start today. Decomposition also is done. Please watch the earlier videos. Right. So when we speak about the displacement reaction, right, let us start an example from your class. See, let us assume your class has a strength of 40 students. Okay. In that, one student, like, you know, some set of students would be good, some set of students would be above average, some students would be below average, some would be, like, you know, all varieties of students. So see, everybody can't come to the first level or everybody can't achieve that. We have got whatever God has given us, we are blessed with that, feel happy, right? Now here in that, always there is a competition between 1, 2, 3 ranks, isn't it? So the third rank tries to get the first rank, means the third rank child displaces the first rank child. For again, second rank again do that, 10th rank again will fight for the second. Like that, there is a heavy competition where one student will work hard and just take the position of the other. Whatever, what is happening, they are replacing the position of others. In the same way, metals also have a series of reactivity. Just like your classroom, I said, these are the series of metals. And as your classroom, let us assume you are grade 10th A student. But here, the reactivity series is the name of the classroom of the metals. Here again, we have list of metals which have different reactivities. Among these, we have three categories. That is, from potassium to carbon is one. So this is one slot. Again, from zinc till lead, this is one more slot. See, here what happens is, from potassium till aluminium, if I have to say, these are highly reactive metals. Highly reactive metals. They're very strong. They can replace anything. Next. In the center, whatever we have here, these are middle reactivity metals. Middle reactivity metals. Okay. Now, after this, from this copper till down, whatever are there are called least reactive metals. Least reactive metals. Now, what is the fun in this? Let us understand. Always remember, as I said, there is a competition between the highly reactive, middle reactive and least reactive metal as in your class. But important thing you should note in displacement reaction, right, before writing the definition, remember highly reactive metals. So highly reactive metals, what are they going to do? They are going to displace. Highly reactive metals are going to displace least reactive metals. So highly reactive metal displaces least reactive metals. Remember this. That means these metals, suppose if these are there, this will come and replace this. Ma'am, I'm not understanding. Let us understand in different way. So this concept you need to remember. So highly reactive will displace least reactive, not the reverse order. Okay, I noted this. Now let us write the definition in this form. So displacement reactions are those reactions. Let us write the definition with this only. So displacement reactions are those reactions in which, okay, see, I already wrote the definition here, isn't it? In which highly reactive metals displaces the least reactive metal. That's all. This is the definition. That means if I take the general formula of displacement reaction, let us see. Here, this is AB, this is plus C. Okay, now here I'm saying, understand carefully, this is least reactive, LR. This is highly reactive, HR. I'm writing like this. Okay, first is least reactive salt we will take and highly reactive metal we take. Now what this does, the highly reactive metal will go and replace the least reactive metal and it will push out this. How does it look now? Suppose A, B plus C are reacting. Now C goes and displaces A. This becomes, the product becomes CB plus A. See here. A is pushed out, isn't it? Why? Because it is least reactive. Now shall we start understanding with an example? Let's see that. Suppose, okay, I hope you have noted the definition, students. I'm taking out the definition part. right? Now let us assume we are performing an experiment which is there in your NCRT. So NCRT has given you an example with an activity where we have taken copper sulfate solution, we are dipping a zinc rod in that. I'll be showing this in the animated video, please watch that. Very interesting, how does the color change from blue and how copper is deposited on zinc rod, the brown color one. Everything I'll show it in the animated video, please watch it. Now let us take an example. Suppose example one, suppose here I have a salt that is copper sulfate, okay. Now I have something called zinc added to this. Now tell me which is least reactive among these two. See this order. The least reactive is copper. So copper is in the least reactive position. Where is zinc? Zinc, 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 zinc is here. Okay. So which will replace which one? The zinc will replace, as I have written earlier. This is AB. This is C. Now C will go and replace A. A is pushed out. Okay. Now same thing. Zinc goes and displaces copper, and the product which we get is, see here, zinc sulfate plus copper. So copper, it deposits on the zinc sulfate, the rod which we have taken, as I said, which I'll show it in the video. Now let us take one more. Suppose here I have one more example. Let's see, magnesium let us take, highly reactive metal, and I'm going to take copper only again, right? Now I'm going to take, instead of copper sulfate, I'm going to take copper chloride, let us assume. So I'm going to take magnesium. Now which is stronger? This is stronger. This is highly reactive metal, this is least reactive metal, because it is down in the rank. So what will happen? Magnesium goes there, replaces copper, and copper is pushed out. So what product will I get? I'll be getting magnesium chloride plus copper. Copper is out, see here, because it is least reactive. Let us take one more example. Now little change I'll take. Now suppose if I have a salt like this, sodium chloride plus copper, tell me now which is least reactive in this. Immediately, as soon as they give me, I know this is least reactive. Which is highly reactive? So this is LR, this is HR. Now among these two, tell me, will I get a product? Means just like this exchange. The answer is no. So here the answer is no reaction. Why like that? Because copper, or it is least reactive, it can't displace highly reactive. What according to the definition, displacement are highly reactive or the middle reactive will displace these. This one will not displace this. Remember that. So no reaction. Shall we write one more? Let us take. You can make your own examples, no problem. Now I'll take with this. Now zinc sulfate I have, okay. Now zinc sulfate is here, I'll take one more, plus magnesium. Now tell me students, which is highly reactive among these two? Where is zinc? Zinc is here in the middle reactivity series. Where is magnesium? Magnesium is above. So the magnesium rank is more, greater than zinc. So it can immediately go, displace zinc out, and it will pull out zinc. So what product do I get? I'll be getting magnesium sulfate plus zinc. Zinc comes out. So this is nothing simple. So displacement reactions are this. So let us take more examples and understand. But what to remember in the exam? Basically, the color changes is what you're supposed to remember. So we will write list of reactions and we will see whether the reaction will happen or not. Oh, that is point number one. After seeing that, we will also see what is the color change which happens. In the exam, the examiner will ask you the product, the examiner will ask you the color change also. Let's come back and list out all the displacement reactions. Hope you understand, but remember to watch the animated video which is there at the end of the explanation. Right. So now we have understood the concept. Now I have written, listed out few examples here. Remember, I'll be writing some more examples. Now let's see. Now you have an idea. These are highly reactive metals. These are middle reactive metals, and these are least. So least can't displace these. Middle can't displace this. Remember that. Let's see. Now here, as I said, the earlier one, this is also silvery white, or zinc metal also, right? Silvery white. Okay. Right. Now see here. First thing, copper sulfate solution was there, blue color. zinc I have taken as a metal, remember. Now where is zinc? Zinc lies here in the middle reactivity series. Now where is copper? Copper is somewhere down. So obviously we understand zinc is more reactive than copper. So I'll write zinc is more reactive than copper. So this will go and we get zinc sulfate solution, which is colorless in nature. Okay, and because this also is colorless almost, and copper deposits as a reddish brown deposit, means the rod becomes reddish brown. You can see the animated video, right? So this is done. Now in the second case, copper sulfate plus magnesium. So magnesium is more reactive, copper is least reactive. So compulsory, magnesium displaces and I get magnesium sulfate. Initially copper sulfate was blue. Magnesium is silvery white metal and it becomes colorless, right? Because it has displaced completely, and reddish brown copper as usual. Next example. Here again I took copper sulfate, so copper sulfate is down somewhere, least reactive. Then I took iron, so Fe is here. So easily Fe can displace copper sulfate. So initially copper sulfate was blue. After Fe has displaced copper from here, what do we get? We get ferrous sulfate. Now ferrous sulfate color is what they're going to ask you. So it is a greenish solution. The green color solution is ferrous sulfate. Now initially iron was gray. After combining with sulfate, it has become into a greenish solution and it has pulled out copper. As usual, copper is reddish brown in color. Simple. Let us see one more. Here we have a salt that is copper chloride. Now copper, you need to concentrate on the metals only, non-metals nothing to worry. So copper again is the least reactive metal. Which one did I take? I have taken lead. Now where is lead? Lead is here. So as I know, it is above copper. So obviously lead will go and displace copper. See here, initially copper chloride was which color? It is a green color solution, right? Lead was bluish gray color. After displacement, the lead chloride has become colorless, showing that colorless solution, showing that the lead chloride has formed. As usual, copper, reddish brown copper has, it goes and deposits on lead. In that solution, whatever rod, lead metal, whichever you are placed, no, in lead metal, that lead metal, if this copper goes and deposits. So this is how is a displacement reaction. So remember, once again, I'm telling you, highly reactive metal are going to displace least reactive metal. Point number one. Second point, middle reactivity metal will display, middle reactive metal can't displace highly reactive metal. So the criteria is that. Let us come and see some more examples. Right, now let us come back and see some more examples so that your concept is completely clear. Right. So here, what did they give us? They've given us a salt solution that is silver nitrate. Let us go back to the chart and see where is silver. Silver is lying down, so it is a least reactive metal. Then next comes copper. Copper also is lying down, but the concept here is copper is the first least reactive metal, then comes silver. So easily copper can displace silver. That is the concept. So you need to remember the reactivity series, it will be easy for you all. So here what happens, silver nitrate is a colorless solution first. What did I do? I have taken copper in that, copper metal in that. So here, as I said, copper is going to displace silver, and what are we going to get? Same thing, copper nitrate. Ma'am, how did I get two? Here silver nitrate, I have got only one. Here you have written two. Here the valency of copper is two, no? That's why I have written two. Here silver is plus one, nitrate is minus one. Okay. Now the copper nitrate, whatever is formed, is a blue color solution, and silver is pulled out because it is least reactive, and you get a grayish white deposit on that particular thing. So on the copper metal, whatever is there, silver gets deposited, grayish metal, you will be, powdery metal will be deposited, which you can see the color. Now that is the understanding. Why did I give so many colors? Remember students, you will be asked the colors only. First thing they'll ask you whether this reaction is possible, point number one. Second, they'll ask you what is the color change. That is point number two. Point number three, they may ask you the compound formed when so and so metal reacts with this and the solution is greenish in color. So you should be careful. That's why I have given you a lot of colors. All are covered in that. Right. Now here they have given one more. Let us solve this. Here they have given me iron. Okay. So here Fe, let us see the rank, which rank it is getting. So Fe is somewhere here in the middle reactivity series. HCl, hydrogen hydrogen is below H, so immediately iron will go and displace hydrogen, isn't it? So what do I get? I get FeCl2, and hydrogen gas is evolved out. So metal plus acid is salt plus hydrogen gas. Simple. Now balancing I'm not doing, I'm just giving you the information. Balancing you should do because you've already learned it. Now magnesium, where is magnesium lying? So magnesium rank is somewhere high. It's almost in the first five ranks. Where is hydrogen? Hydrogen is down. So automatically magnesium goes and displaces hydrogen. I get magnesium chloride plus hydrogen gas. Simple, isn't it? Now let us see sodium and water reaction. Right, where is sodium lying? Sodium is somewhere rank, almost second rank it has got. What does it have? It has water. So hydrogen is somewhere down. So automatically sodium goes and replaces hydrogen, and I get NaOH plus hydrogen. Okay, right, this is over. Ma'am, how did I get that? Let us see. Here water, I think I can write it as HOH. So NaOH, and if you balance, it is hydrogen. Right, next copper. Copper oxide plus magnesium. Where is copper lying in the rank? Copper is lying down. Okay, where is magnesium? Magnesium is lying somewhere up. So high, isn't it? So obviously magnesium goes and displaces copper, and I get magnesium oxide as well as copper is out. Right, now see here, see the arrows. So Fe is displacing H, magnesium is displacing hydrogen, sodium is displacing hydrogen, magnesium is displacing copper. So these are the list of reactions. Now after understanding, now let us come and learn the important reaction, that is thermit reaction. Right, students. Now let us come back and do the important reaction, that is thermit reaction. So as the name suggests, therm means heat. Now here basically in thermit reaction, you have the combination of, as I said earlier also, but important here, the combination is iron oxide plus aluminium. Now here aluminium, instead of this aluminium, we can take magnesium, we can take potassium also. Right. Now we will see whether the reaction is possible or not. Where is iron? So Fe is somewhere here in the ranking. Where is aluminium? Aluminium is above. So aluminium has got a rank above iron. So easily aluminium goes, and now let us write, aluminium is more reactive than Fe. Right, because of this, aluminium goes and displaces iron and pulls out iron out. So what do I get? I get Al2O3. Ma'am, how did I get this Al2O3? Again confusion. Let's see first the formula. Now here aluminium oxide. Now see, I'm getting little bit diverted. No problem. So aluminium atomic number 13, oxygen atomic number 6. I'll write as KLMN shells. Oxygen KLMN shells. So aluminium 2, 8, 3. 2 plus 8, 10. 10 plus 3, 3. Oxygen 2 plus 6, done. Now aluminium, always metals will give electrons to non-metals, remember. So how many it can give? It can give 3 electrons, because after giving this 3 electrons, this can become stable. 8 is stable, 18 is stable, right? 2, 8, 18, 32. All these are stable configurations. So it can give this 3 to oxygen. So this becomes, this takes. Now cross it. So the valency of aluminium here, according to this, is plus 3. The valency of oxygen is, that means it requires 2 electrons to become stable, minus 2. Now cross it. Aluminium I'm crossing, oxygen I'm crossing. How many do I get? Aluminium gets 2. Aluminium gets 2. Oxygen gets 3. Oxygen gets 3. That is how the formula has come. So let me erase this out. You have noted, I think. Right. So here aluminium oxide comes out. Along with this, iron is pushed out. And this is where is the magic. In this particular reaction, lot amount of heat is generated. Lot amount of heat. Highly exothermic reaction. Remember, thermit reactions are also called as exothermic redox reactions, exothermic redox reactions, right? One is gaining oxygen, one is losing oxygen. So here exothermic means lot amount of heat is generated. I also explained what is meant by exothermic reaction in the previous video, watch it. So during this heat, whatever is there, that heat is used in welding railway tracks. So that heat, what they do, the molten form of this liquid, I mean molten means you know, no, the liquid form of that high metal oxide, that iron will be there, isn't it? That liquid form, whatever is there, because of this heat, this will be obtained in the form of a liquid or the molten form. So that metal, they take it and they used in joining railway tracks. So joining railway tracks, a simple thing, isn't it? Railway tracks, nothing. Why, ma'am? How did I get? As I said, because this is an exothermic reaction, that heat will maintain or keep that metal in the molten state. So I can take, put it on between two railway tracks and leave it for cooling, it will join off. Yeah, right. Please watch a video also, you will have, like, you know, when you type thermit reaction, you can watch a lot of YouTube videos where hot burning iron, a molten state with both, and it is dropped in and it joins. So this is the thermit reaction. Once again, let us define. Thermit reactions are also called exothermic redox reactions, point number one. Second, in this, highly reactive aluminium displaces iron and gets converted into aluminium trioxide or aluminium oxide, right? And iron is obtained in the molten form. During this process, there is a lot amount of heat which is generated. With that heat, the molten liquid is taken and they are joined, they pour it in between two railway tracks, which will join like this. So this is used in joining railway tracks. So this is your displacement reaction, student. At the end of the video, there is an animated video also where I'll be showing the activity which is there in NCRT where you take the iron nails. Please watch the animated video, because making an animated video, it will minimum take 2 to 3 hours. So thank you for watching the displacement reaction. Let us come and meet with the next video, that is double displacement reaction. Thank you for watching. Thank you.
Thank you.